maybe the judge want to choose number 9, he choose number 10 because he don't see good. Don't put this in the camera, I'll kick you.
Away from the West Bank and the Gaza Strip, modern Israel is in the throes of change. Its younger generation is largely uninterested in the old conflicts and knows as much about Goa as the Golan Heights. Last year, Israel celebrated its 50th birthday, and since then there's been a feeling of optimism in the air. An election was coming, and hope was growing that the right-wing government would be toppled. It seemed as if almost anything could happen.
מלכת היופי של ישראל לשנת 1999 היא היפה מכולן, מספר 8, רמה רזון.
Then in March this year, Rana Razlan was chosen as the new Miss Israel. Her victory seemed in tune with the atmosphere of change, but it was also controversial, because Rana is an Arab.
I have no problem if she's an Israeli citizen. I've got no problem with her being in a beauty contest, being with Miss Israel. I mean, the fact that she's an Arab, that's another issue altogether.
You know, we're all equal. On the other hand, I wish a Jewish girl had won the pageant.
Rana may not have been Jewish, but she was an Israeli citizen. And if a transsexual could represent Israel in the Eurovision Song Contest, why not an Arab Miss Israel? She won the crown, the car, and a lot of media attention.
It's just a political thing that it was the right thing to do. Kind of like Dan International won Eurovision last year. I don't particularly think that she was the best candidate.
Miss Israel have to be Jewish, but if they want that, they be Rana.
If choosing her was a political decision, Rana wanted it to be known from the start that she had a voice and her own views about her new role.
Et lui que j'ai préféré le Negev, c'est ce que je préfère.
Non, c'est pas ça, non.
Alors, qu'est-ce
non, il demande quelle est l'impression qu'on a de Miss Israel. Hein? You want our feelings about Miss Israel?
Yeah, because she's an Arab.
Yes. Well, we are very happy that Miss Israel, Miss Israel is a woman.
After the announcement, the media went wild, and Rana Razlan was front page news.
She has not been chosen because she is an Arab. She has been chosen because she was really the most nice one. And she had something very nice about her, and she was pretty and lovely. And she had a personality, and that's why all the judges chose her. But really not because she's an Arab.
The fact that an Arab woman was recognized as anything is something wonderful. And the fact that it's winning her a stage in which she will say something, whatever she says, it will be one of the first times Israel will be listening to an Arab woman's voice.
Yesterday, I received one call from one guy. He said to me, listen, you chose Renee. She's an Arab, so I said, so what? What is the problem? We are all people, and we chose her because she was beautiful, not because she was an Arab. Why you chose an Arab? Why not?
Rana Razlan was born into a Muslim family in Haifa, a port town in northern Israel, where relations between Arabs and Jews are relatively peaceful. Wadi Niznas is a typical Arab neighborhood, quite poor and close to the harbor. The Arabs who live here are Israeli nationals. They hold Israeli passports. But like most Arabs, they suffer discrimination and are often treated as second-class citizens. Rana is proud to be an Israeli, but she was still stunned by her new title and found it difficult to believe she'd been accepted by Jews.
I was in shock, you know, because it's the first time that they choose Arab. Before 13 years, they choose the second place Arab. She was Christian. But this, I don't know what's happened to them this night. Maybe they drink a lot of beer and they didn't know what they make.
Rana always had spirit. Encouraged by her mother, she started to enter beauty contests early on, and by 19 was the improbably named Miss Arab Sector. But life has been a struggle for the Reslan family. Rana's violent father deserted them when she was 13, leaving the family without a breadwinner. Rana's mother, Faida, divorced him, but the dishonor that brought meant the family was looked down on by other Arabs. Her older brother, Ashraf, was recently released from prison. His crime was to stab another Arab who'd been allegedly harassing Rana. It was a matter of honor, extremely important among Arabs. The court sentenced him to 6 years behind bars. Now he can't get a job. For the family, there's not much prospect of things getting better. And Rana's mother, who works as a sous chef, can barely support them.
We don't have father to keep us, but we have mom better from father because she's good and she's strong. She's not a bad woman, she's good, she cares about us. And now everything changed, everybody wants to meet me, everyone to want to know me. Before, a lot want to marry me, but then look, your family is this, yani, I'm not from good family. Now everybody want to meet me, want to, the same. Why? Because this queen, this world, it's not fair, I think.
On the one hand, the family is pleased for Rana and pin their hopes for the future on her career. On the other, the pressure remains for Rana to marry quickly in the traditional Arab manner.
Until now, 22 and a half, I didn't marry. Everybody look about me that, wow, what's this? Because the Arab married quickly. I don't want, if I want to marry, I will marry from 16 years, but I don't want this. I'm child, until now I'm child, I make like child. I don't know.
Somebody that he respect her and he will be good with her. Not shouting, nothing. Never mind money. Money, it's nothing.
One person.
Yes. Not, money, it's the end. It's
relax.
Nothing. But respect and love, that's all. We have time to marriage. She has a lot of time. Maybe more, 1 year, 2 years. Never mind. Yes.
5 years.
Not 5 years. Why 5 years? 1 year is too much.
Winning Miss Israel is just the beginning. Now Rana goes forward to the International Miss Universe competition. It's her entrance onto the international stage and her chance to go from rags to riches.
Giovanni Russo.
The fact that she comes from a poor background doesn't really change much, except for the fact that, for example, we try to get her more clothes and more accessories and shoes and so on to make her feel confident. Whereas for other girls, they have lots of their own. And she had less, so we really try to ask more sponsors and more designers to help her out, and everybody was very willing.
I didn't have one, you know? I didn't have one. Before I go fly, some shops, they give me present. The ones that I succeed. Look how much, they give me a lot. Why? Look. I didn't have even one. Look how much. A lot.
All right. She was elected. She's Miss Israel. Fine. But now she has to show everybody who is Rana and what is she willing to put into that title.
I'm Rana, I can't change myself. Even they want me to change. In Israel, they ask for me to change. A few things that stop to be nervous, stop to cry, stop to speak loud. But it's my voice. I don't shout or this. It's my voice like this. Everybody thinks, you know, I can't change. I don't want to change nothing for me. It's Rana, love me like this. Who will love me? Who will love me like person? Who don't love me? He have problem. Yes, love
one. Rana is about to be hit by the glamour hurricane. Watch me. She will join 84 other beauty queens and several hundred journalists in the Caribbean for the 1999 Miss Universe pageant.
This jacket is the best. Give me luck.
For a young woman who's hardly ever left her hometown and who's not allowed out at night, it is truly another world. Miss Universe is a multi-million dollar operation, part of Donald Trump's business empire. The women, judged to be amongst the most beautiful in the world, have jetted into the tropical islands of Trinidad and Tobago.
You look about the Miss Universe and they say, wow, wow, so beautiful. I didn't believe. It's a dream, you know, and I must thank Israel because they bring me to here to present to Israel. They're so good.
The delegates, as the beauty queens are called, are on show for every waking moment of the day. And Trinidad itself, usually a sleepy, sultry place, has suddenly become a magnet for photographers, journalists, and admirers of the female form. Security is tight at the four-star hotel where the delegates are staying. So for security, economy, and as a symbol of cultural exchange, they have to double up. It's potluck which nationality they end up sharing with, and in Rana's case, it's turned out to be Miss Great Britain, and they're both suffering from a lingering jet lag.
Thank you, I can't open my eyes. I'm so tired. Her name is...
Cherie Pisani.
She come from?
Clacton-on-Sea. Sometimes in London.
Rana's mother has also made it to Trinidad. An Israeli businessman paid for her air ticket, and within a few days of arriving, a local woman offered her a room in her house. So now Faida's staying in the suburbs. Luckily, her new friend Gail is also in the beauty business.
It's a very, very, very beautiful place, like a heaven. And the people here is very kind, like angels. They help everybody. We haven't like this in Israel. We only in Israel, quick, and shout. Here, peace, nobody shout, nobody make nothing.
By 10 a.m., the delegates have already been at the mercy of the international press for more than 2 hours. They have a punishing schedule of rehearsals to follow, and access to the girls is strictly regulated and enforced by their personal chaperones.
I don't know what to say. I look after her. She's like my little sister. And when I have to tell her what to do, I tell her what to do. When it's time to joke around, I joke around. You know, we have a great relationship. And hopefully we'll stay friends for the rest of our lives.
The competition is in several stages. First, all the delegates are questioned by a panel of judges. In the space of just 4 minutes, they must impress complete strangers by the power of their personality and intelligence. The questions range from which animal would you rather be to discussions about politics.
I was asking about things that she would like to see change in this world, and she certainly, you know, mentioned the issues in her own country and her feelings about that. And again, as I say, you know, her feelings were very strong, she was very, very committed to them, and you know, it's a quality that we all looked for. And I have to admit, she really impressed me in the 4 minutes.
They asked me about one judge about them, that I'm the first Arab. They asked me about my country, which place I will take them. Some very nice player football, he started to speak with me about football, and that's my favorite subject. It's a question that, you know, in the first I was so afraid, so nervous, I didn't know what I will make, how I answer, I didn't want somebody to help me in English, you know, because I believe that it's best when I talk with you, I talk for us and not to him and after, it's not me. And I try all my best and this was good.
Trinidad has been independent from Britain since 1962, but it's not yet a tourist haven like Bermuda or St. Lucia, and many of its citizens remain poor. But they're all fiercely patriotic, especially since Trinidad won the Miss Universe competition last year. This year, the Trinidad and Tobago government put up $10 million to attract the pageant to the island. Most people think it's money well spent. There's a great deal of speculation and excitement over who will win, especially because the local girl, Nicole Dyer, is one of this year's favourites.
He's going to make this country widely known because I understand some 2 billion people will be watching, right? And of course, with a little bit of patriotism, I wish our Miss Trinidad and Tobago win.
Miss Venezuela seemed to be the trump card in the whole set, but I'm still behind Miss Nicole. It's going to be great for the country.
I love Miss India.
Mexico.
Venezuela.
I would like Nicole to win.
She's beautiful. She has brain.
Miss Israel. She looks good. She looks good.
It has a sort of a fever, something that we haven't felt here for years. Since after the World War, there's a certain fever in the country concerning the thing.
Come on, sweetheart. We have to go to the bus.
Okay.
Three busloads of beauty queens must now be taken to the other side of town, and outside, security is even tighter. Every day they set off in convoy with police cars, outriders, and even ambulances to escort them. So far, things have gone off without a hitch. The pageant itself is taking place in the safety of the Chagaramus Arena, a converted aircraft hangar at the northwest point of the island. As well as participating in a beauty pageant, which could lead to fame and fortune for the winner, the bottom line is that they're part of a business. And that business is to put on a live television program beamed all over the world to an audience of more than 2 billion people. There are several set pieces, the swimsuit section, evening dress, national costume, and the delegates are already under intense pressure to be absolutely frame perfect. It's arguable that these young women are being exploited by huge commercial interests and that it's nothing more than a meat market. But for Rana and the other beauty queens, it's much more complicated than that.
It's a step of making lots of money for a few years, and why not? It's the only business that women earn more than men, which is fantastic, isn't it, no? I like this fact, you know. Except in my business too, I earn much more than men. And I'm quite happy about that too, that I did it my way, all by myself, without getting married to any rich guy, and sitting on a swimming pool all day and doing nothing and getting bored.
Round four, thank you. Ready, round five. Round five.
This is the nerve center of a slick professional operation which sells an idealized image of beauty to the world. And like it or not, it works.
I'm looking for a society where people are going to be measured according to their peoplehood, who they are. And what they look like is just a small measure of what they are. And in beauty pageants, we focus on what they look like. Beauty pageants also perpetuate a standard of beauty, which is almost unattainable. I don't know if you're aware that beauty queens shave their arms. Of course they shave their legs, but they're almost completely hairless. They don't have normal sizes. They're very thin and very tall and very young. And they are such a prevailing model of beauty that 12-year-olds who have a normal body look at themselves in the mirror and give you this long litany of complaints that they are not symmetrical and they're hairy like a gorilla. I have a 12-year-old at home that's hairy like a gorilla. Well, you should see that gorilla.
We have 8 minutes to get changed into swimsuits, okay?
2 years ago, Miss Universe was given a makeover. New management brought in a fresh concept of the beauty queen. No longer was it enough to have a pretty face and a certain type of figure. Of equal importance had to be intelligence and ambition. Miss Universe, runs the corporate line, should be nothing less than a representative of the modern woman. And the winner must also dedicate her time to increase awareness, educate, and raise money on behalf of an official cause.
It's entertainment, it's light, it's fun, it's fantasy, and that's always the best way to slip in a serious message. If you're on guard and looking for that serious message, you already have your preconceived notions and that kind of thing.
Thank you very much.
Hearing it from a young, very attractive woman certainly, I think, could impact on the situation in Israel with regard to their Jewish population and the Arabs, you know, and simply because they're not expecting it, you know. So in the euphoria of Israel winning a title like this, they're certainly going to want to listen to what this young lady has to say.
Israel, what's the most important piece of advice you would give the next generation of women?
I would say that she wants to work that world peace. All the world wants to live about world peace and to try to make peace, because we live one time in this life. We must enjoy for every second.
I agree completely. Good answer.
There is a unique perspective here, because as a feminist, I'm sister to all men and women who struggle against beauty pageants. I think they're terrible. However, I'm also fighting racism in our society. And the fact that an Arab woman was recognized as anything is something wonderful.
Thank you very much, Israel.
As rehearsals enter their second week, Rana's wish for world peace was still a long way off. But in Israel at least, it looked as though something was changing. Ehud Barak had won the Israeli election, but it was the Israeli Arab vote solidly behind him that counted. Barak had promised to help them, and when Rana heard the news in Trinidad, she was overjoyed.
We win, everybody tell, we win, like I win, Barak win. I hope so, really, that he will be good, not in talking, really. He will make things that they help us and Jewish to be together and peace.
After Yitzhak Rabin's assassination by a Jewish fanatic in 1995, the peace process stalled, and the Israeli Arabs' hopes of improving their situation were dashed. The State of Israel was established explicitly as a Jewish homeland, and its Israeli Arab citizens have suffered in many small ways as a result. Whether Rana's status as a cultural ambassador for Israel is evidence of a greater acceptance is debatable.
This massive support for Barak means that we want that Barak will utilize this golden opportunity to make the historical change. We are not so optimistic. So Miss Israel will not do what we did not succeed to do through the parliamentary activity, through the municipal activity, through struggling in all fields against the policy, not against the country. That's why we always say, in Hebrew, by the way, we say, "Anahnu lo neged hamedina, anahnu neged hamdiniyut." We are not against the country, we are against the policy of the country.
Miss Israel, why did you enter the Miss Universe pageant?
Okay, no problem.
Why I entered this? Because I want to present my country.
This is the Miss Universe internet room in Trinidad, where fans, indeed anybody from around the world, can go online to question the delegates about almost anything.
Stupid question. Why I come here?
Miss Israel, like Miss Ireland and Miss Yugoslavia, is having to answer questions on political matters. And Rana especially has become a focus of media interest following Barak's victory.
You have Mr. Ehud Barak in place now. How do you feel about that?
You can't see how much I'm happy. It's very good, and I hope so that he make peace, really peace, and believe about the world peace, not just speak. Make. I want somebody to make.
Hold on a little while. We're having some difficulty.
Stuff flying at me here. Real time. Are they coming on? Okay, good. Great. All
right. So when you win the Miss Universe crown on Wednesday night, what are you going to do?
Barak, me, peace.
Thank you very much. Okay.
Although Israel is the official homeland of the Jews, the territory is also home to more than a million Arabs, whose families have lived there for centuries. When Israel was created by the United Nations in 1948 and was immediately attacked by its Arab neighbors, some Arabs in Israel fled, but those who stayed became Israeli citizens. Technically, they're just as Israeli as the ultra-Orthodox Jews in Jerusalem's Mir Sharim district. In reality, the Israeli Arabs remain an object of suspicion and discrimination. Whenever Arabs rub up against officialdom, they're forced to confront the fact of their difference. This was recently brought home to Rana when she flew to Eilat in southern Israel with some Jewish models for a fashion shoot.
They take me in the airplane there. They didn't check the girls of the Jewish. 2 minutes and they go, me? Maybe I was Hamas, they didn't check me like this. They check my bag, they ask the Jewish if it's okay, if I'm okay, where I go. I tell her on Thursday we make the fashion. She told me, you tell me that in Friday, you know, she want to check really if I'm model or something. And they give me feeling bad when I go to the football games. All the time they shout about me, Arab, Hamas. Now when they choose me to Queen of Israel, it's changed. Everything is good and everything that I'm really queen. But sometimes they say, if something happens, they will look about me all the time that I'm Arab. It can't change in Israel.
There are few Arabs in either the bureaucracy or the professions in Israel, despite the fact they make up almost a quarter of the population and 16% of the electorate. They're underrepresented in most jobs. In July, the Observer newspaper reported that of 1,000 flight attendants on the Israeli airline El Al, not a single one was an Arab. An Israeli MP said recently that if Rana Reslan applied for a job there, she too would be turned down.
We want to feel really an integral part of the Israeli society, but what's going on ground since 1948 until this specific date unfortunately, proves the opposite, because the Israeli governments, leftist or rightist, since 1948 until this specific date, did not do everything needed to bring the Israeli Arabs to feel that they are an integral part of the Israeli state.
Rana winning a beauty pageant is far from being a real step towards showing Arabs in general, and Arab women in particular, as equal people. They're not. real changes are. What is the percentage of Arabs in the local councils, in the Knesset? What is their percentages in the arts? How many of them work in the highest echelons of the bureaucracy? How many of them have money? Once you look at these statistics, you see that they are invisible and silenced. They're not really part of this society, even though there are almost 1 million people. Rana is just it's a fluke. It's a media hype. It's a way of selling more cosmetics because it's very interesting.
Ladies and gentlemen, the swimsuit parade.
But if some Israelis have problems with Rana's Israeli identity, she has a bigger problem with the Islamic world. No beauty contest would be complete without a swimsuit parade, but not everybody approves of the flesh on show, even in easygoing Trinidad. A local Muslim leader has denounced the immorality of the Miss Universe pageant in the Trinidad press, and some of his criticism is leveled at the Muslim women taking part.
We are giving Satan an open invitation to come into our hearts and our minds and sow the seeds of corruption. Today, we are in the middle of the build-up to an event which comes off in a few days' time, and which represents everything against the haya, the modesty and shame of Islam. This event is said to project extraordinary modernism, but within there is unlimited nudity, disrespect and desecration of the sacred status of women and their exploitation.
We as Muslims, the cornerstone of our belief, in fact what forms the cornerstone of anything in Islam, with respect to Islamic morality is our modesty, guarding this at all time. And Orthodox Islam perpetuates and promotes this as much as possible. The extra exposure of the flesh, the carnality, and the immodest behavior and lack of concern for those people around them who may want to be so. We feel that this is not right. And as one of the saints of Islam has said, that there is no Islam, there is no religion without morality. And there's no morality without modesty.
First of all, I don't want to read this because if he's Muslim, he must go to Jame to pray to God, to read Quran, and to not speak about women. And if he sees something about women, to not speak about her. That's God what say in our religion. And I don't know and I don't respect what he say. I respect every person what he speak, but I don't respect when he put in the journalist. You don't need the attention from this. No attention from this.
He says that the pageant is disrespectful to women.
Everybody, every woman, her choice what to make in her body. We are free in free country. He must care about his daughter and his wife, that's it. I think. Why my country didn't speak the Muslims about me? How I can put me in, how I can put clothes? It's my body, I want to make with my body. I know what I make. I don't make bad things or bad mistakes or things. It's normal in my familia. I don't want to speak about them.
The honor of the family lies in her conduct. And many times the honor of the family will dictate when she'll get married, to whom she'll get married, and what kind of profession she will have, if at all, and how many children she'll have and when. Now these decisions really are, this is what her life is going to be. And very rarely you find a Palestinian woman who is willing to challenge these men around her. And this woman pays a price. I know some of these women, and they're some of the women I admire most in my life. Because God knows what strength it takes to take on the whole family and culture and to say, here I am, introduce herself. At least I had other models. These women didn't.
I will respect my mom. If my mom tell me, don't come to her, I will not come to her. Don't put this dress, I will not put this dress. Don't go to this place, I will not, because it's my mom. That's it. I don't respect nobody else. Just my family and myself, and that's it. It's my type. Maybe they'll say, oh, wow, she's a bad girl. How she can speak like this? It's me. I will not change myself, and I will not speak what the people want to listen. I will speak what really I feel. It's my type, I'm so hard. If my manager was with me, she would kill me.
Rana Aslan wants to be the most famous actress in the world. If This former makeup artist is very proud to be the first delegate from Israel of Arabic descent.
There's only one more day to go, and the dress rehearsal with national costumes puts Rana once again in a difficult position. It's been decided that her dress should be the Star of David, symbol of the State of Israel, but also the symbol of the Jews. Rana finds herself personifying the very thing to which, in many ways, she cannot truly belong.
It's too much. Too much, you can't, a little bit. Because I can't. I have so...
You're the first girl, and you're up here. You won't get lost. Remember to look for my figure. I'll be there.
All the contestants are under pressure, and after 3 weeks of rehearsals, the strain is beginning to tell. A small article in the local paper announced that Miss Guam had returned home for medical reasons, but it was no stomach upset. The following day, the truth came out. She'd been disqualified because she was pregnant. Miss Philippines made the headlines when she slipped over on stage during the evening dress section a few nights earlier. Even Rana has had a day in bed feeling under the weather.
Thank you very much. Okay, ladies, stay right there. Thank you. Big smiles, ladies. Let the judges take one last look.
Now, you can come as late as 9:30, but if you come at 9:30, you have to be ready to leave. You have to be ready to get on the bus.
Yes.
Because if you come down at 9:30, you can't go back up to your room. Okay?
Desayuno en la mañana comienza a las 8:30.
The next time Rana and the others make this journey, it will all be over. The new Miss Universe will have her crown.
One last thing. Miss Namibia has misplaced her watch. She thought she dropped it in her bag. She might have accidentally put it in someone else's bag. Who knows? Okay, but if you'll just check, please, she'd like to have her watch.
Hotel, the delegate's day is still not over. With the final tomorrow, even more press and media has arrived from the far corners of the world. So before the beauty queens can fall exhausted into their beds, there's another 2 hours in the lobby of the hotel with photographers, interviewers, managers and advisors. And family.
You will do that. You're beautiful. Thank you. Thank you very much.
At midnight, they manage at last to escape to their rooms, anxious for some precious beauty sleep. Donald Trump is flying in for the final at any moment. Trump wants to develop casinos and golf courses here for the rich, and Trinidad is longing for the trickle-down effect. For the moment, though, a job at the pageant as a waiter, security guard, or musician is all that's on offer. But for the winner of tonight's contest, a new life begins the moment she's crowned. A big cash prize, a $40,000 a year salary, a plush New York apartment, an international lifestyle with infinite possibilities for the future. The 4,000 seats for tonight's event were sold out months ago, and the audience queuing to get in is in a carnival mood.
My cousin is Miss Colombia. She's beautiful and she's smart.
Puerto Rico! Puerto Rico!
I'm afraid. I'm afraid. Yes.
Why?
I'm not sure that she will win because it's not in our country or something. But maybe she wins.
Please take your seats now. Thank you.
Welcome to Trinidad and Tobago and to the biggest party in the universe. Tonight, one of 84 delegates will walk away with my crown.
Live from Trinidad and Tobago, the 48th annual Miss Universe pageant.
There's been endless speculation over which of the delegates will make the final selection. The moment of truth for 74 of them has now arrived.
Here are the top 10. Spain, Mexico, Jamaica, Puerto Rico, Philippines, Ghana, Botswana, South Africa, India, Venezuela.
So Rana is out. It's a huge disappointment, but she keeps on smiling as the judges narrow the field for the last time.
In my hand are the names of three delegates who still have a chance to be crowned Miss Universe 99. In random order, Spain!
Speculation continues right up to the last moment. By now, the girls know each other very well. Friendship has eclipsed rivalry, and tears are mixed with hopes for the ones still on stage.
Tonight, the first runner-up and winner of a cash scholarship from Oscar de la Renta Swimwear is Philippines, the 1999 Miss Universe Botswana. This evening started, you were 1 in 84, now you're 1 in 1,000,000.
I don't know, the judge choose, not me. If I will choose, I will not choose this. Not she, she is great, but I will choose maybe top 10, another top 10.
Yeah.
I don't know. Everything good. All the girls here so beautiful, and everybody queen to her country. That's it. Bye-bye.
For the new Miss Universe, Miss Botswana, the responsibilities of the job have already begun. A photo opportunity for the sponsors and TV executives, a press conference, and then she'll be whisked away to New York and a new life.
I don't care, you know. I want just to finish from this and to go home back. That's it. I will not change Israel, never ever. It's the best country that we have. That's it. You don't want to go to sleep, sleep, sleep.
Good night.
Good night, and thank you.
Rana Ruslan is also beginning a new chapter in her life. Her homecoming is the real start of her reign as Miss Israel, and she hopes the start of many opportunities. But Rana must also return to her Arab community. From now on, she faces some tough choices. Many young Arab women and men look up to Rana as a model of inspiration and achievement. Her career can take her in one direction, but the undertow of tradition is bound to pull her back in the other, back to her roots, and probably an Arab husband who would forbid the lifestyle she's pursued.
You know, I want to succeed in my life, to succeed with models, to work outside and inside from Israel. And I don't, this is my dream. My dream was Queen of Israel, and I have my dream. I want to learn. I want to go to school to learn English, that because all the world understand one language, it's English. I want to succeed in models. I want to succeed to present Israel. And I don't know what's happening. I want to find Bosch. Please find me.
Rana's cousin is getting married in the ancient Arab city of Akko. As the family gathers for a pre-wedding party, it seems to crystallize Rana's dilemma. Her mother wants a better life for her, but above all, she wants her to marry. The Miss Israel title has brought the family pride, but as yet has earned her no money. And the longer Rana pursues a modeling career, the more she will isolate herself from the Arab community.
It will be a lot of the dance, a lot of food, a lot of panic. You will be in shock what you will see there. But it's happy. It's for us happy.
Rana has very little time before she will have to make a life decision, whether to go against her mother's wishes and pursue her new career or accept the traditional role of an Arab wife.
You need me up? I'm sorry that I'm late. Look about my face. Up, come on.
Rana's caught between wanting the same freedom as many young Jewish women, but also feeling uneasy in the secular, westernized world. When her reign comes to an end in a year's time, the pressure on her to marry will be enormous, perhaps overwhelming. Rana's conflict mirrors the position of many young Arabs in Israel. It's a time of change and uncertainty. But if an Arab in Israel can only belong by becoming westernized, is that a price worth paying?
There is nothing older than a used beauty queen. She's going to have to make this stage sustain itself, and she'll have to reach out to every young girl and young woman in the Arab sector and tell her there's much more than beauty in me. I think she has to have some initiatives of her own to make this role into something bigger than just a beauty queen. Otherwise, she will be just a little blip on the screen of the history of Arabs in Israel.
You know, at the first I start to cry and I say, why they make me this? I dream about this. My family is happy. I'm happy. I make history to my family, to every person that will love me. I don't care. I want that the people speak about me. They will not forget my name.